I'm Joe Demento. I'm professor of law and planning and the director of the Newkirk Center. I have a very pleasant role. It's a brief role to introduce our topic, final topic, and a really eminent speaker and colleague. But first, I'd like to make a few observations about what we've heard today and what that may mean for our topic of governance. We've tried to break this down into several segments. As to the role of law, we've learned a lot. We have learned that legislation exists in this area, but that more legislation is needed, which makes me, a scholar of international environmental law, a little concerned, because we also are very cognizant of the paralysis of international law. And perhaps we could talk about that over a cup of coffee. Second, we've learned that much of the existing law works pretty well with a backdrop of considerable international interest and cooperation, the posturing of politics pre-election notwithstanding. We've learned that in the absence of this cooperation promoted by law and other things, that there is still a need for litigation. And considerable litigation is going on in those areas where cooperation can't be realized under the existing approaches. We've learned that law can also provide the means of structuring the way we introduce information into the decision-making process, and it has done so fairly successfully. Secondly, as to the role of traditional knowledge, we've heard about indigenous peoples' contributions, which are great in quantity and great in influence, including regarding the Arctic Council. Are these insights or are these qualitative data? Is there any hierarchy between indigenous insight and knowledge and scientific information? We've learned also that it's not clear on how we integrate this indigenous knowledge. As to the role of science, we've learned a lot. We know quite a bit about a major factor in the future of the Arctic, the existence of the oil resource. We've learned that we know how to know about the seafloor with that amazing revolution in how to measure depth and determine topography. We've learned that, however, overall, we know a lot in some areas, but we're told that the Arctic is very poorly understood. And I was surprised to hear that analogy. We don't even know who eats whom in the oceans. We've also learned science from another point of view we're learning a lot from, and that's the growing social science that researches quite successful about how we integrate various forms of knowledge for action. And finally, we've learned, and this is science and policy, the precautionary principle should be applied in this region. As to the role of the arts, it's wonderful to have the arts introduced into our work at the Newkirk Center. We've learned through those amazing clips from the forthcoming videos that art can help us connect emotionally in a way to international problems that are extraordinarily important and translate that to action. We learn and benefit from each of these areas. Our focus today is on the Arctic, but the lessons are valuable to other regional seas as well. Last May, we focused on North American regions. Next March, we hope to see you all here again, as our focus will be on conservation of the California coast. And here at UCI, we're doing a lot of work on the other regional seas as well. We're focusing here, and as we moved in to Professor Young, on governance, the totality of activities that seek to provide rational, effective management of the sea. Historically, that term is thrown around quite a bit without real clear understanding of what its public policy considerations are. People call for good governance, and we move now into a session where we get some greater sense of what that might mean. And the way I do my work, we look to good governance not by assuming away the complexities, like describing how we need to internalize external cost or address the problem of free riders. For the kind of work we're doing here on the regional seas, we look at the complexities in management challenges that we have to address. Capacity deficiencies of different groups, competition for funding at the international level, what we've heard a number of times today, waning political will about environmental concerns, mismatches between scientific needs and management capabilities. So we'll learn a little bit more as from our next speaker, and I'm really honored to introduce him. Introduction should be short, unless they're substantive. Mine will be both. Dr. Young, Orrin Young, is professor of institutional and international governance and environmental institutions at UC Santa Barbara. You'd think that area was designed just for us in this conference. His work focuses on the analysis of environmental institutions with particular reference to international regimes. He serves as co-director of the Program on Governance for Sustainable Development at the Bren School. He served for 6 years as founding chair of the Committee on the Human Dimensions of Global Change of the National Academy of Sciences and chaired the Scientific Steering Committee of the International Project on that program. He chairs the steering committee of the Arctic Governance Project. Before that, he was vice president of the International Arctic Science Committee, chair of the Board of Governors of the University of the Arctic, and co-chair of the Arctic Human Development Report. He's written extensively in the area. Today, he will address the relative lack of systemic and systematic thinking about policy options designed to protect the cultural and ecological integrity of the Arctic. He asks how to promote the evolution of the region as a zone of peace and environmental protection. And as you'll hear, he'll do so with a tone reflecting much of his work. It's analytical, calm, thoughtful, and experienced.
An honor to be here. I've known the work of the Newkirk Center for some time, and Joe is doing a wonderful job, and this conference has been throughout very interesting. I see my role here this afternoon as to reflect a bit on what you've heard during the course of the day and to try to put it into some perspective. To suggest some ways that we might organize our thinking about what's happening in the Arctic that you've heard about, and to talk a bit about ways forward, particularly from the point of view of management and governance. So, of course, some of the thoughts you'll hear have been in my mind for some time, but I'm also trying to reflect on what I've been hearing in the course of the day, so I've been trying to articulate my thoughts as we go along, and so you won't see a PowerPoint. But then again, I think it's not such a bad idea to have a presentation without a PowerPoint. Let me just make a couple of brief comments about my own background. I went north for the first time in 1973. To study some questions about the management of natural resources. And I was particularly interested in resource management at the international level, and I began to think about questions of governance, what we call management regimes, and so on. And I was a fairly mainstream social scientist at the time. But this is kind of an aberration which many of my colleagues kind of tolerated. When I came back from the North in the early times, I said, well, I'm really interested in these questions about resource management in Beringia. I said this to one of my quite eminent economist colleagues, and he said, I didn't know you were studying exotic diseases. So I said, well, it's kind of the North Pacific and the area kind of beyond the North Pacific. But anyway, I've been going back to the Arctic ever since, not only the North American Arctic, but the Eurasian Arctic. I thought some years ago when I came to California that I maybe would back off from the Arctic a bit. Maybe I needed a break, but of course it didn't work. And now, now I'm in the thick of things about the Arctic, the interest in the Arctic has mushroomed so dramatically, so now I have to make an adjustment from being the only person in the room with this kind of slightly odd interest in the Arctic to being at a time when I knew absolutely everyone who was doing Arctic work to being now surrounded by people who are interested in the Arctic and not knowing what a lot of them are doing. This is fundamentally a positive thing. It's a good development, but it does take a bit of adjustment. Now, what I want to talk about in the next minutes here can be divided into kind of three lumps. That's kind of a precise term, three lumps. First of all, some comments on the nature of the change or changes that are taking place in the Arctic and the characteristics of those changes, which I think are particularly relevant for thinking about questions of governance, management, regime building, and so on. And then some questions, then some comments about paradigms or discourses, that is, kind of intellectual frameworks that we can use to try to help us, to give us some orientation, to sort of help us to organize our thinking about a place like the Arctic. And then finally, the third set of comments, implications for governance or ways forward. Now, coming then to the question of the character of change, it's beyond doubt that the Arctic is experiencing transformative change. You have heard people talk about this throughout the day in terms of things like climate change. Climate change, as we've said, is real. It's happening. It's dramatic already in the Arctic. In terms of things like globalization, in terms of feedbacks, which is one of the most sort of striking characteristics of this change. But here are several ways of thinking about this change which I think are particularly relevant from the point of view of resource management. First of all, the changes that we are now experiencing in the Arctic are nonlinear. They are, in many cases, rapid or abrupt, and they are certainly irreversible. This is the combination of characteristics which most people have in mind when they talk about a state change. A system, a complex system that is undergoing or has undergone a state change. And when you have a state change, surely you need not to assume from the point of view of governance that business as usual will be satisfactory. You need to rethink your approaches and your procedures and processes for governance. Another characteristic of the change which the transformative change now occurring is what I call a linking change. That is to say, it is intensifying or strengthening the links between the Arctic itself as a region and global systems. Not that the Arctic was ever unconnected. But the links are now very dramatically clear. Of course, this is the case with climate change. The Arctic is at the leading edge of the impact of climate change, but the Arctic is not, the certainly in anthropogenic terms, the causal agent. And so what's happening in the Arctic with respect to climate change is very much a response or a set of developments that are reflecting things taking place elsewhere in the planet. And the same, by the way, is true with respect to economic development. All of these visions that people have about large-scale commercial navigation or large-scale oil and gas. I mean, oil and gas is not going to be developed in the Arctic to light the lamps of the Arctic. And it's going to be, it's because of the voracious need for these resources on the part of lower latitudes. So what's happening in the Arctic, and this is also very important from the point of view of governance, is this linking change. We cannot address the governance questions in the Arctic without taking into account the connections between what happens in the Arctic and what's happening elsewhere. And then a third characteristic of the transformative change occurring in the Arctic, which strikes me as particularly significant from a governance point of view, is, and it's been stressed by a number of people today, is its uncertainty. Of course, it's scientific uncertainty. You just heard the previous speaker say, well, how much sea level rise will there be in 2100 resulting from melting of the Greenland ice sheet? Well, you saw that envelope that he had of the range, the error bars, and so on. And one of the other, I think it was Professor Blake's, or someone else's error bars on the various greenhouse gases. But it's not just scientific uncertainty. With all due respect to the estimates that we hear from people like USGS with respect to the yet-to-be-found oil and gas in the Arctic, and I fully respect those estimates, we don't know what's there. We don't know whether there will be another Prudhoe Bay. In fact, Prudhoe Bay, as I recall, was discovered with a test well, and the people were just about to give up. They said, well, let's drill one more. And that was Prudhoe Bay. And so if I'm an investor, there's a high degree of uncertainty as well. And, of course, there is the question of economic uncertainty. We seem, at least to a degree, to be recovering from the collapse of 2008, although last week's election might lead you to have some questions about that. But resource development in the Arctic is always expensive resource development, and much depends upon the state of the economy. For example, there's at the present moment in the sort of global market, there's lots of natural gas around. I mean, there's natural gas all around. And so I would hate to be in the position of having to make a large bet on exactly when natural gas from Stockman will hit the international market. It won't be right away, that's for sure, and it may be some time off, depending upon, you know, all the other gas that's around. So uncertainty is another feature. Whether or not this is a reason to follow the precautionary principle is another matter. The precautionary principle is one of those principles that's pretty elastic as to what it actually means operationally when you apply it to particular cases, and I'm not necessarily advocating that in this case. But so these are the characteristics of changes. Now, in a situation like this particularly, and here I come to my second lump, it's always true, but perhaps particularly true in a situation like this, that people need some kind of conceptual framework. I mean, all these things are happening in the Arctic, and how do we make sense of this? Can we construct some kind of a paradigm? And there's really no choice about this. Whether it's implicit or explicit, whether you articulate it explicitly or not, you have some kind of a framework in your mind which you construct to try to help you figure out what's going on, to sort of make sense of a situation of this kind. And one of the things that's really striking as we see the mushrooming of public attention, someone showed the Time magazine cover story on who owns the Arctic, and there are a lot of others of this kind, that there is a very sort of striking tendency to choose a paradigm or a frame of reference which falls into the what we social scientists tend to call the realist or the realpolitik or the geopolitical frame of reference. This is a frame of reference which emphasizes the role of states, high politics, power politics, and creates images which we see now in the media everywhere in thinking in articles about the Arctic, the idea of a new Cold War, the idea that there will be resource wars, the idea that there's going to be great conflicts over jurisdiction. Some people have taken to saying, well, there's going to be a new great game in the Arctic. This is a not-so-veiled reference to what happened in the 19th century between Great Britain and Russia in the Middle East. One of the most striking things about this paradigm of realpolitik is that it is most widely used among those who know the least about the Arctic. In other words, it's kind of a simple paradigm. If you are on assignment for your newspaper, got to file your story, you need some kind of framing device to organize it. It's easy to glom on to this one. But those with expertise, most of us feel that the relationship between this paradigm of realpolitik and reality is tenuous at best. So why does this paradigm persist? I've asked this question of myself a number of times because I've talked to many people who use this paradigm and obviously haven't had much influence. So I'm thinking, what's going on here? One is that this paradigm is very easy to grasp. Almost anyone can understand, well, power politics and countries fight each other and they have these sorts of conflicts and so on. Another one is that it tends to sell newspapers. It's provocative. People somehow or other, I mean, you know, it's the same reason why the newspapers have all the articles about the murders and the car accidents and the fires and so forth. You got to be provocative, especially in this day and age where people's attention span is about 7 seconds. So you've got to say something, Cold War, or something like that to get them to look anymore. And it's also true that there's a shred of evidence that there are some conflicts. I think Michael Byers this morning, with whom I agree 90%, is a little bit rosy in his characterization. There are issues, and they're not trivial. But perhaps the most important concern here is, in order to move off this kind of emphasis on the realpolitik, we need some alternative paradigm. We can't just say, well, that's not useful, and then babble about lots of things that aren't kind of put in perspective. We need some other way to think about it. And I don't have the answer to this, but it seems to me that where we need to be going is toward systems thinking, complex and dynamic systems, and systems which are socio-ecological systems, that is, coupled systems of human and biophysical forces at work. It seems to me that if this way of thinking is important anywhere, it's clearly important in the Arctic at the present time. And if you follow this way of thinking, it's a couple of things become clear. One is that preserving the Arctic, I think that's the term used in this meeting, preserving the Arctic environment is not the only issue. If we think about preserving the Arctic environment, and that's the only thing we think about, we're not going to get very far. Why? People live in the Arctic. There's industry in the Arctic. There are very important cultural issues in the Arctic. And there are sort of issues of the complexity of Arctic marine and terrestrial systems. We need a kind of more holistic or integrated approach in which we pursue some notion of stewardship, not by declaring the Arctic off limits, but by building the kinds of understanding and coalitions that we need to go forward in a collaborative, I would like to say even cooperative, way, joining the residents of the Arctic, joining people who are in places like Irvine, California, with a more complex sort of systemic paradigm which suggests that the Arctic is one of the places where we need first and foremost to think through the complexities of managing socio-ecological systems, the complexities of what it really means to do ecosystem-based management, spatial planning, and those kinds of things. And that then leads me to my third lump of questions. I'm looking at the back, and I'm still within Joe's dispensation. A couple more minutes. The third set of comments, which are the implications of what I've been saying up until now, for governance or for management more directly. The first thing to say is the Arctic does not resemble the Antarctic. Someone said this morning the Antarctic is a continent surrounded by water and the Arctic is water surrounded by a continent. Well, that's true, but that's actually, in point of fact, not the most important issue. The most important issues are the Arctic has people who have been there for thousands of years and who are really significant players. The Antarctic has a small population of scientists which dwindles to about 700 during the winter, austral winter months, and anyway always have the opportunity to be flown out. The Arctic has a world-class industry, the oil and gas industry, the fishing industry, mining of various kinds. The Canadian Arctic, as someone pointed out today, is the second largest supplier of diamonds in the world. The Saha Republic is a major supplier of precious metals. It's world-class industry, and industrials are not going to go away. The Arctic also is, whether we like it or not, militarized. The Arctic has been in the past a theater of operations for highly advanced weapon systems. And I think that it's easy to overdo this, but on the other hand, one of the key features of the international regime for Antarctica is strict demilitarization. And that's not going to happen in the Arctic. So what will happen in the Arctic from the point of view of governance? I think that there will not be, I could explain this at length, we don't have time now, there will not be an Arctic treaty, as some people have suggested and would like there to be. What is much more likely to happen is the development of what we call a governance complex. That is to say, a collection of regimes or management systems or agreements that deal with various kinds of focused issues that are somewhat connected to each other but are not fully integrated. We often talk in terms of governance complexes about the spectrum from integration to fragmentation. Full integration is where everything is connected up and tied into one coherent system. Fragmentation is where you've got a bunch of things with no connections among them, whatever. I think the real issue will be where do we find ourselves, and can we move in a constructive way along that spectrum, perhaps toward a somewhat more integrated outcome. And these things will happen at different speeds. Some of them are happening already. I think Paola mentioned earlier today that we think it's probably 90% certain that within 2011 we will have an international coordinated search and rescue regime in the Arctic. We are also moving in the direction of a mandatory polar code regarding commercial shipping. We already have had non-mandatory, voluntary guidelines for a number of years. This is likely to emerge as an agreement within the framework of the International Maritime Organization, the IMO, and it is likely to cover both ship design and construction and ship operation. I think the probability of a polar code of that kind coming forward is a high probability within the next 2 or 3 or 4 years. We are likely to move in the direction of one or more additional regional fisheries management organizations, RFMOs as we call them. It is already the case that a slice of the Arctic, mostly in the Barents Sea, is covered by the Northeast Atlantic Fisheries Convention, and quite successfully, the bilateral Norwegian-Russian cooperation on fisheries, which is a very sophisticated system, goes back to the 1970s. We have an international agreement in the Bering Sea, and I think there's a very good chance that one or more additional, not Arctic comprehensive, but Arctic, but regional fisheries management organization will develop. I think there's a fair prospect that we will develop some kind of an international, perhaps non-state arrangement to deal with Arctic tourism. Some of you may know there is an organization called the International Association of Antarctic Tour Operators, IATO, but the amount of tourism that's developing in the Arctic will dwarf the tourism in the Antarctic, and tourism is one of the largest and most rapidly growing industries in the world, and it tends to attract, particularly in more exotic places, not Las Vegas, people with considerable wealth and resources. And so some kind of development along those lines is quite possible as well. What I think is perhaps the biggest challenge in this regard for the foreseeable future is to find a way to move forward in the Arctic context and the circumpolar Arctic context with ecosystem-based management and spatial planning of one kind or another. This is the kind of perspective that really emphasizes the notion of systems thinking. I think there's no obvious, simple way forward in this respect, but I do think that probably the best forum for moving our thoughts in this direction is through what Paula described as the Arctic Council, an organization created in 1996, which has performed better than almost any of us who were present at the creation would have predicted at that time, but which also is in need of continuing upgrading. And let me just close with the remark that I believe, without being naive in any way and without expecting it to solve all of our problems, that there are significant opportunities for strengthening and upgrading the Arctic Council, to give it a proper financial base, to give it a proper secretariat, to provide more opportunity for non-state actors to have a significant voice, to provide a way for other actors like China, the European Union, for example, to have some opportunity to participate in discussions about issues of Arctic governance. And if you think about what I said about the linking changes, the linkage changes, the idea that we can address the issues that are emerging in the Arctic while at the same time giving a cold shoulder and saying thanks but no thanks to China, Japan, Korea, the European Union, is ludicrous. There's no way that we can do this. It's certainly understandable that the Arctic states themselves want to stay in control to a certain degree, but if we are to move towards some system of stewardship, ecosystem-based management, spatial planning, a systems perspective on these coupled systems of the Arctic, we need to be somewhat more inclusive. And one of the big challenges that many of us are working on at the present time, both in government and out of government, is how to reform the Arctic Council without losing its important distinctive characteristics, like, for example, the distinctive role for indigenous peoples, which is a unique feature of the Arctic Council, but in ways that will make it a more significant player, a more significant force in addressing these questions of governance that grow out of the transformative change that's occurring in the Arctic today, and through some paradigm of systems thinking, coupled systems. And I would end on a note of moving us in the direction not just of preserving the environment, but in the direction of stewardship as the proper metric to be using in thinking about where we go next in the Arctic.